And if you like to learn more about great people or cowboy stars, go to cowboyron.com. That way you can take your time reading them. Again, that would be cowboyron.com. One of the categories is cowboys and sidekicks. Now today, we got a great series, a great show for you. We're going to talk about Leonard Franklin Sly. And Mr. Sly had been a singer, performer, well-seasoned, with a great fan following. And today he's going to make some decisions that he thought would be fun, not knowing that was going to propel him to stardom and into the American Western mythology. One decision, he's at RKO's studio prop room, and he has to pick out a cowboy hat. And he finally finds one or two that will suit him, but it's not the hat that will become his signature cap, signature hat, with the double horseshoe on top. And then he has to make another decision. Leonard Sly is not a name that brings up cowboy superstars. So it's one of the prop men or assistants suggested that he would Leroy Rogers. And Roy did not like Leroy because of a person that he knew that was just not a nice person. So he accepted another suggestion, Roy Rogers, shortened it to Roy. And while they were making a decision, someone mentioned that Roy in German means king. And you got it, folks. The King of the Cowboys was born. That would ride off in the movie history. Stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. But going back a little bit earlier on Roy's life, he was born in Ohio in 1919, but he was born in Ohio. He was actually born 1911, and he died in 1998. His father was a hard worker, but kind of poor, and him and his older son, they built a houseboat. The houseboat would be the home until he had the great flood in Ohio. And all his father did was untie it, and they flowed with the current, went down with the stream. Now, later on, Roy, he never finished high school, although he was very bright, he just was not his thing. But the family, to entertain ourselves, would play music on the weekends, a musical family, and other people would join in. And finally, Roy started performing professionally. He performed with the Sons of the, he helped form the Sons of the Pioneers, which went on to make many records. He eventually was on the radio stations, then went to Hollywood. They performed out in California, and they made over 50 records before Hollywood invited him out to be a cowboy star. Now, Roy, he made B-Western movies, and what that stood for, back during the Great Depression, they thought people were not going to have the money to go to see Western movies, or see any kind of movies, so they came out with this double feature. And B would be the stood for bottom. And it was about a 60-minute movie. In fact, Hopalong Cassidy made a bunch of them, then bought them up and cut 12 minutes off and put them on radio. He worked with Bob Nolan. And once he got into the movie business, he bought trigger on credit. The people that brought out the animals, the stock companies, and Roy told the owner that if he would let him have trigger on credit, that if he made it big in the movies, he'd make sure he got some plenty of business. Now, Roy's first couple movies was not with Dale Evans, who would eventually become his partner in life. But he was making a movie when she came on board. She'd been a radio singer for years, and she was divorced. She got married when she was 16. But they were making this movie, and for some reason, she had high heels on. And Roy Rogers cautioned her not to tag those horses with the heels, or else she would have a great problem. And she pretty well told him to mind his own business. In fact, she will tell you in her biography, the book I read was Happy Trails to the West. Happy Trails to the West is a great book. But she pretty well told him to mind his own business. She was not very impressed with him. But she kicked that horse, and the horse went into a dead run. And she was not a horse person at that time. And like the B-Western movie stars, John Wayne and the people like that, he put his horse in a dead run, rode up alongside of her, put his arms around her waist, and lifted her to safety. And she would tell you after that, Roy was her only cowboy. Now, Roy had been married three times. First time, the marriage didn't work. The second time, his wife died. And not to say he'd been married two times. The second time his wife died. Dale would be his third wife. And Dale would help him with babysit and help him out with the kids. He was a great father. Always loved children. Always loved animals. And they eventually got married. And he made quite a few of the B-Western movies. And he became one of the number 10 all-time cowboy stars, movie stars. He sang, he played it, he actually made more money doing it shows, singing with the Sons of Pioneers than he did in Hollywood. But eventually that was, in the 50s, cowboy B-movies were dwindling, losing their popularity because people were looking for more of a sophisticated movie. Things like John Wayne and Randolph Scott, Audie Murphy, and people like that would make a little more serious, a little more intrigued in them. So they eventually decided to go on television. Now, they produced a lot of that Roy Rogers show at their ranch in California. But they spent quite a bit of time deciding what was appropriate for children. They were always mindful that children, that entertainers should put a proper example for children. So it was coming in tradition when you had a 30-minute movie that the girl would be a barmaid, you know, like in Gunsmoke and Lawman. But they did not want to project that image to children. Again, great examples of entertaining, adhering to the responsibility to the young ones. So they decided that Dale would run a diner. That way Roy and Pat Brady, they could go in there and drink a coffee and decide how they were going to take care of the evil doers of the American West. That was on television for about 8 years, but then Jackie Gleason's show became so popular that they took Roy Rogers off. One thing I forgot to mention, when he was a movie star, he now had Trigger, and Trigger was getting more fan mail than Roy Rogers. I repeat that. Roy mentioned on television one time that Trigger was getting more fan mail than him. But a hospital called Roy. And Roy took the call, And they said they had a young man who loved Trigger and Roy Rogers, but the boy had had major surgery and was not getting healed like he should. His mind was just not getting with the program. And they asked if Roy would talk to him and give the boy some encouragement. And of course, Roy gladly did that. He was right there. And when he talked to Rusty, I think it was his name, he says, "Rusty, now if you'll do what the doctors say, take your medicine, eat, as soon as you're able, you can come down to Air Ranch and you can ride Trigger all that you want." Isn't that great? Two TV stars going to take this young man under wings. In Roy's book, Happy Trails, he mentions that, "Rusty, I haven't heard from you lately. Please give me a call." And one other time what Roy did was they lost a child and they were at an adoption agency. He adopted three children. Great with children, him and Dale. And that's why I consider them to be cowboy and cowgirl saints. They went to orphanage, and a young boy came up and wrapped his arms around Roy's leg, but the lady at the adoption agency motioned for Roy to come over, and she said, "You don't want this young man," and she explained the baggage that would come with him. He had been in two or three different orphanages, been abused physically. At one orphanage, if he didn't do his chores fast enough, they'd put him in a chair on the porch in the rain, sleet, tie him there, make him stay out in the rain for an hour or so. So Roy and Dale, they left that orphanage and went home. Well, Roy woke up at 1 o'clock in the morning. I repeat, 1 o'clock in the morning. And he said to himself, "If I don't take this young man, who will?" And he called the lady at 1 o'clock in the morning. And he got the little boy. Immediately, once accepting the child and getting home, he took 2 weeks off from studio and took him and Rusty camping for 2 weeks to help the boy to acclimate to his new environment. And, you know, and really being outside will heal many things. He adopted some more children. He was very active in his church. The Merritt Corporation, you've seen the Merritt hotels. They actually got started in Washington, D.C. with Hot Shoppers. I lived not too far from there. Diners, and then they went into motels. And they decided to go into the fast food restaurant. And they worked out a deal with Roy to use his name. And they have Roy Rogers restaurants. They had hamburgers, chickens, and there's not very many of them still in business today, but there's one in Frederick, Maryland, where I had a privilege to perform with them doing ropes, whips, and guns. Roy still continued to sing. He was on television with Lee Majors and The Fall Guy. But you look at his clothes. I can remember as a child looking at those fringe shirts. It was like a walking Christmas tree. I have a few of them that I use my entertainment. The public likes them. And I was a little disappointed on television that Roy Rogers was now fighting the outlaws with his French shirt on. He had work clothes on. You look at his gun belt. He had a double gun belt designed to do tricks and things. So Roy is riding off into the sunset. There is a song I heard the other day, and I don't remember who the singer was. It was called "The Day That Trigger Died," and you can get that on YouTube, "The Day That Trigger Died." Roy was a great inspiration to children in my age. You learn things like, you know, to fight fair. If your opponent was down, you got back up and then continued to fight. Stealing was not only wrong, it was unthinkable. To love your country, to love your parents, was also values that he contributed. So this is Cowboy Ron, hoping that you like this. We'll be getting this thing a little bit better as I learn how to edit this. Hope I see you next time. So signing off with happy trails on the west. God bless.